Hey guys, it's Christopher Lewis and welcome to another episode of Dating Intelligence. And I just want to say it has been a good minute, honestly. So this is going to be the new season opener for season, I think, number five or six. Anyways, I'll let you guys figure that out as we run through this season stuff. You'll know better than me. But anyways, I'm excited to say we're going to have a bunch of new and great guests this season. Lots of things to talk about. But first, I just want to let you know what's been going on with myself for a quick second before I introduce our guest. The summer's been great, just been really busy. And for the most part, you know, I've actually become an international dating coach this past summer, which I'm super excited about. I decided to think outside the box like I normally do in my life, just think of something that's going to be helpful to others, as well as to bring my services to other people out there who are in need of dating coaches. And so I decided to go international this year. So I reached out to companies in London, Canada, and to the on Australia front as well, and got some great hits. And now I'm collaborating with a few companies here and there and been helping clients all over the world now. So it's been exciting for me. I got one in Greece, one I helped out in China, and a few other ones all across the board. So I'm going to keep informing you guys on how that's going, and hopefully we'll get some calls in and some questions answered that you guys always give me at the end of the season and things as well. But right now I'm going to jump into the show and jump to our first guest of the new season. And this one's a good one. So my guest co-host today is the definition of time management. She's a TV personality who has been seen on The Real Housewives of Beverly Hills. She has mastered juggling time between her marriage to a former NFL player, motherhood, and career as an in-demand anesthetist who helps patients in surgical centers throughout Los Angeles area. In her downtime, she finds the time to hit the gym and is frequently seen on the red carpet supporting numerous charity events. Please welcome the beautiful and amazing Annemarie Wiley to the show. What's up, Annemarie?
Hi. So much for having me.
You're so welcome. Thank you for doing this. Now, I know it's been a minute. We've been talking back and forth for a while through a mutual friend, actually. And so I'm going to give kudos to that mutual friend. Hey, girl.
Hi.
All right. So she got us together, but I'm just really happy that you actually are here on the show. So thank you.
Same. I'm super excited to be doing it.
Good. Well, how was your summer? How is your summer? Ooh. Now, you know, because this is the season intro right now, so we're just going to see how the summer was for you. I know you got kids and all that
jazz.
Oh
my gosh, yes. My summer, everything revolves around the kids. So we have three kids that are at home with us, 9, 4, and 5.
Okay.
And so it's, you know, juggling their athletic calendars, their camp calendars,
right,
all of their extracurriculars and everything, trying to take them, you know, got to take them on a trip.
Okay,
in the summertime,
of course,
or whatever.
Yeah, right.
But you know, actually the...
Never for your benefit though, right? It's always for the
it's
kids.
It's always for the kids. But you know what I actually did for myself this summer?
Please.
And Chris, I was very, very proud of myself. I went on a girls trip to
France. Okay.
And I had so much mom guilt before I went because, you know, I'm like, oh my God, everything's going to fall apart when I'm gone and I'm leaving my husband with all the kids and everything. But I prioritized myself.
Good.
I went on this trip and I had the best time. I came back and I was so refreshed. And so I had
all
a wonderful summer.
I'm glad you took some time out. And guys, what she's saying is that as all parents, we all feel that guilt, especially 100%. When we, God forbid, we take time out for ourselves, right? When we have kids, because they will definitely be like, why are you taking time out for yourself? But also here's the other thing too. It's like, how was it scheduling all that stuff for the summer for kids? Because I know it's almost like a frenzy to get them signed up for camps, to get them signed up for their sports events and all that, things like that as well, right?
And in Los Angeles, you sign up for summer camps in like January.
Right.
Like January, February, March. So it's like a big puzzle that you're putting together.
Okay.
So, but you know, it runs like business as usual. Our house, we call it Wiley's World, is literally, it's a machine.
Good.
It's
I like
a machine
that.
Of plugging everything in, making sure everyone's got the time and attention, everything is scheduled. And then of course we always, you know, prioritize family time because that's the most important thing for us. So
I appreciate that. I appreciate her. And are you the one that's running the helm of the ship, by the way? Are you the captain? I appreciate any captain out there, because sometimes my ex for me, like, she goes, by the way, I just signed the kids up for this. And I'm like, okay. I'm just like the okay man. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Okay. And it's like, you know, God forbid if she goes, well, I didn't get them the horse camp this year, but we got them in the mule camp because we were so late in doing it. You know, it's like ride a donkey versus a horse because she's so late to sign up sometimes, and you're scrambling to get that extra. Hopefully one kid drops out, you know?
Yeah.
That's a tough one as well.
No, that's my job. We delineate things in the house, and like taking care of like those kinds of tasks, those are on my table.
Good.
I do that traditionally. emotional kind of stuff.
So, I love that. And yeah. It keeps you, like I said, it keeps you really busy, I'm sure.
Oh, it
too.
Sure does.
So how do you find time now between all that, you know, not to even talk about your philanthropic work?
Yeah.
Another tongue twister. When you find time with your career as the demanding nurse and your busy schedule is that, how do you juggle all these things going on here?
That's a great question. Mm-hmm. You know what? For me, it started when I was very young. So I started sports when I was 5 years old.
Great.
Ran track, switched over to basketball when I was 12, played through high school, and then I played through college. And playing basketball in college is really what taught me time management.
That's great.
Because I was taking my kinesiology courses, and then I switched over to nursing. But I was obtaining my nursing degree while I was playing. And with that, it was like, you know, early morning field track practices.
Right.
And then middle of the afternoon practices in the gym. And then after your classes at nighttime, you have film.
Okay.
And then, you know, on the weekends, you're either away playing or you're in town and you have games, your home games. So I was doing all of that and I was working 3 jobs.
Wow.
So I was working at our schools, you know, what do they even call them? Like funds where you're raising.
Okay.
I was the call centers.
The call centers. Gotcha.
I was one of the people at the call center. Hi, would you like to, you know, support as an alumni? I did that. I worked with an autistic child and I would run camps at our school. So I
Unbelievable.
Was constantly busy.
Okay.
So that's where I learned time management. And so now when I apply it to my life now, it actually seems easier than it did at that time.
Okay.
Right?
Right.
Because now I have a husband that helps me and supports me. And I have certain things in life that are established. So like, yes, it's really, really busy, but that's just kind of my engine.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
I
thrive
that.
Off of being busy, but you know, it really just comes down to prioritizing what is important for you, because
right.
we all have the same 24 hours in a day. And you know how they always say, if you want something done, give it to a busy person. You just you prioritize your time.
Right.
So how do I work out? I wake up at 4:30 in the morning and then I lift and then I spin. And then we get the kids ready for school, out of the house at 7:30, take the kids to school. If it's a work day for me, I work, you know, part-time. If it's a work day for me, my husband will take them.
Great.
I go to work, do all my stuff. If I'm off that day, then I take them. He picks them up in the afternoon. And then the days that I'm off of I call it my real job.
Okay.
My nurse anesthetist job.
Yeah.
That's my real job. The days that I'm off that, that's when I'm, you know, working with our foundation project transition. Or, you know, I have been working with the March of Dimes. I just co-chaired an event for them actually 2 days ago.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah. So,
okay.
You know, it's like, it's just balancing your time, making sure that everything can be slotted in while maintaining your priorities.
I love that. And,
yeah.
And you know, off of that, Annemarie, a lot of people, I actually had a conversation with this with a friend about a week ago. And it's like, you know, when someone wants to start, like, you know, obviously we're all busy in our lives, you know, and it's that thing where I tell them all the time, you have to learn how to manage your time. And so off of this note, a friend of mine was like, you know, like, I just want to start this new business. And so, and he goes, but I, you know, with my work schedule and the kids and wife, he goes, I just don't think I have the time to do it. And I go, but look, I go, if you have a passion and you really want to do something, you'll find the time to do it.
That's right.
You, like right now, what are you doing right now? He's like, well, I'm sitting out drinking coffee and watching, like, you know, I don't know, time, whatever morning show he's watched. I said, okay, get off your morning show right now. Keep your cup of coffee and start writing down notes on how you want this business, new business to work.
Exactly.
And he's like, oh my God. I go, you just found some time.
That's right.
I go, so there's, I don't care if you work 24/7, you make the time. Like, I love the fact that you get up in the morning, you work out early because you know on that day you have a full schedule. So where's my time to work out?
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be before you started or at the end of your day at that point, right?
Well, I never do it at the end of the day.
Okay.
I always do it first thing.
Good.
Because the day will get too busy and then I won't prioritize it anymore. I'm not going to say I won't have time for it.
Okay.
I won't prioritize it. Something
gotcha.
Else will come in there. But because working out and staying healthy and fit is such a high priority for me, I make sure that it's done when there will not be any interruptions.
Love that. Love
yeah.
that. How do you still, so I'm trying to instill this in my youngest daughter right now, by
yeah.
the way, on the same note right now, you know, like she's in this thing where she's like, I'm tired, you know, I don't want to go to school and blah, blah, blah. And I say, honey, I go, it starts now. You know, she's 11 years old. And I go, I don't care how young you are, people out there, you tell your kids, you get them on that discipline track from the beginning. Because I go, if you can't manage your own time at this age, it's going to be easier and easier to start letting things go as you get older. 100%. And I let everyone know that, you know, I'm a huge advocate of discipline as well. Like I get up really early, I'm regimented, but I have found ways to do everything that I always need to do because if I have like 1 minute in that day, I will spend it on something that I feel that I'm super passionate about in order to get it done.
Agreed.
Mm-hmm.
Agreed. Like I don't even watch TV.
Okay.
I don't watch TV.
I love my TV, Annemarie.
See, I
love my TV.
I don't. And you know why? I literally haven't watched TV in years.
That's great.
Like, and the reason why is because I can't just sit there and tune out and watch something because I feel like I'm wasting time.
Okay, so that I can agree with, by the way, because I do turn on the TV, but it takes me about 5 hours to watch one 30-minute show just because I'm stopping and starting and doing things I need to do, and I have to focus on that show.
Yeah.
So in theory, I guess the TV's kind of on, but it's always on pause.
Yeah.
It's always on pause. Yeah.
It's like I feel like I could be doing something useful with my time. You know what I mean? And I'm like, this isn't it. So I'm not watching it.
Okay. Okay. So, well, so off that note then. So obviously you go into the gym in the mornings and things like that. Yeah. That is your personal time. And that's what makes you feel good. That's where you get your self-care.
100%.
Let's say, right? Okay.
100%.
Okay.
That is my time. That is my me time.
Okay.
That is me putting me first. And you know, you can't pour from an empty cup, as they say. That is me filling my cup so that I have these stores to give to my children, my husband, and all the other endeavors that I'm going to be diving into.
That is so great. How do you, I don't want to call it compartmentalization, but I guess I'm going to call it compartmentalization. How do you compartmentalize all that stuff though? Because like, it's like sometimes a lot of us get overwhelmed. I mean, not me personally, but I know a lot of people out there get overwhelmed when they see their schedule, what lies ahead.
Yeah.
And like, even in a work schedule, you know, you see what the day looks like and all of a sudden you just see them already like hyperventilating and going for that like paper bag and you know, that stuff like that.
Yeah.
How do you make sure if you know you have a day that's going to be just like, okay, I'm in it today. This day is going to be like freaking going to war.
Yeah.
You know, how do you handle that?
Keep everything written down.
Great.
So this is where organization comes in, right? I have everything on my phone written down, color coordinated. Any notes I need are there to assist me with getting it done. But I love checking them off.
Okay.
So like when I see a busy day, I'm like, yes, let's go get this.
It's
like,
rewarding.
It's rewarding. That's exactly what it is. I love having my to-do list and being like, done, done, done. Because I feel it makes you feel accomplished.
Yes, right.
So I actually thrive off that.
Okay.
I love being busy and I love... Yeah, give me all the things.
All right, now what if there's a little chink in that day? How do you handle that? Does it stress you out?
That's a different story.
I just wondered because you know, someone's always going to throw a little monkey wrench into the day.
Yes. That is when I get stressed out.
Okay.
But I'm the kind of person where I can't really effectively move on to the next thing until I've solved that one problem.
Gotcha.
So if a wrench is thrown in there and I can afford to take the time to fix it, it's going to be fixed immediately.
Great.
Because I become afraid that I'm going to somehow forget about it and then that task is not going to be accomplished.
I got it.
So I'll dive into that one, get it done, and then just carry on with everything else that needs to happen.
I don't see you feeding the kids at midnight though, by the way.
Oh, no. Kids always come first.
I'm just kidding.
The kids always come first. So
she's
no.
like, you know what, kids? I'm sorry. Mommy didn't finish this one task. I got 20 more to go. You're eating at midnight today.
No. But then that goes back to the scheduling, right?
Yeah, right.
Kids get home from school at 4:00. I make sure that when the kids are home, there's nothing scheduled for our time together.
Oh, that's
if I can
great.
Help it. Yeah.
Okay. That's great.
Yeah.
That's really great.
So,
all right. So let me ask you this now. So let's talk about your time. I know that, you know, you had the opportunity to be on The Real Housewives of Beverly Hills. Congratulations on that. I mean, I used to love watching that show. Haven't seen in a while, but I used to love it. So how was your time on the show for you?
You know, I was really optimistic about it. They had been filming for half the season already when they came to me and they asked me to join the cast. And then it happened very fast.
Okay.
I was literally filming within 2 weeks. So
that's
I was just
great.
Kind of like,
is that every day as well? Is that a schedule like that? Or?
We have Sundays and Mondays. Yeah, there's 2 days that they don't film. And it's not like, it's not all day.
Okay.
Like it's very, you know, structured in that, like, you know when they're going to be there, you know what you're going to be doing essence and like those kinds of things. So, you know, it was just an extra element to add into my schedule. And I would just, you know, work it around like my work and the kids' schedules and things like that. So it was time consuming, but it wasn't terrible.
Great.
You know, it wasn't
great.
As strenuous, I think, as people think it was. And so I was really hoping with the experience actually to be able to share more of my life with everyone.
Right.
And it's actually really funny that you ask about it though, because so when I decided that I would do the show, I actually felt very weird about it.
Okay.
Like I felt like a stigma almost. Like I'm not a housewife.
Person. Gotcha.
Do you know what I mean?
It.
Like
right.
I'm all about women. Like, you know, they're always fighting or what, this is happening. And I'm like, I'm all about women empowerment. I've got three daughters. I want to be a role model for them and for all little girls. You know, I'm very into athletics. I'm very into sports. Like I wanted to like pump positivity. I wanted to be a different kind
seems
of.
Seems like the perfect platform then as well.
Exactly. But that's not what they're looking for.
Okay.
They don't, they're not going to look
like
out.
I said, I haven't seen it in so long.
No,
so I don't know how your season was or whatever like that. But
it was very heavily edited to one thing. So,
okay.
You know, they only showed one clip of my family. They didn't give me a storyline. It was just very heavy to, you know, a narrative that they were trying to go with.
Gotcha. So any scene that you're in, or I don't want to call it a scene, but any time that they're filming you then,
yeah.
It's just kind of like you're going about your day in theory, because if they don't give you a storyline in theory, like how do you run your day on that, by the way?
Well, I mean, it's just a chunk of time. So say
gotcha.
They'll be there for like 3 hours or something, and they're like, this is what we're going to be doing. This is what you're going to be talking about.
Got it.
So,
okay.
Although it's not scripted, it's produced. So yeah, it's very produced.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay. And so leaving that, what was your takeaway from there, by the
way? My takeaway, you know what? It taught me about the entertainment world. And I learned a lot about people.
Mm.
I learned number one, how everything worked. Like, you know, I was so green going into it. I remember we were coming back from our cast trip and I was with all the producers and I was like, okay, so what's the difference between a field producer and a showrunner? Like I knew nothing. I knew absolutely nothing. And so, you know, I learned that side of the business. You know, I learned about narratives.
I learned,
you know, and I really learned to be intentional, I think, with my messaging and making sure that anything that I do going forward, I'm in control of my narrative.
Good.
And
yeah.
In control of, you know, just how you're being portrayed and making sure that it's really you that is coming across so that people understand, you know, who I am as a person and what I'm really about.
Right. And what you love doing and what you stand for, like you said, all the previous things before.
100%.
Okay.
And, you know, I'm somebody that will always stand on integrity.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I'll just, like I said, just going forward, I will always do things that align with who I am as a person. So
That's
I think
great.
That was my biggest takeaway actually from
okay.
doing it.
Okay. All right. So now this question off the same note, off of all of that, then is it, so, if you could do it again in a different platform, different show, whatever it may be, would you do it again?
If I had creative control, yes, I would.
Okay, great.
Yes, I
so
would.
So it's like, so you enjoyed it then. I'm in that note then, because it's almost like if you had that platform, you're like, okay, yeah, I could go on TV again and do this again then.
Yeah, but again, it would, like, you know, the creative control part is the big part for me. And I think now, you know, knowing, I kind of liken it to this. You know, I'm somebody in healthcare that's coming in and doing something in essentially entertainment and marketing. Don't know what is happening, right? Versus you take another housewife who, you know, they're in marketing. That's their world. And then you put them in the show. They know exactly what they're doing.
Of course.
Because they know how to market people. So they know how to market themselves. And so it's like a big game that I felt really ill-equipped to play.
Got it.
And so, yeah, if I was to do it going forward, absolutely. I would be like, this is who I am. This is what I stand for. No one's going to influence me to talk about anything except for the things that I stand for.
That's great.
And this is who I am as a person. And ultimately, it has to come down to inspiring people, motivating people, and showing little girls that there are positive role models to look up to.
I love that.
Yeah.
That's really, really awesome. Okay. And so with that being said, then too, for you now, I'm hearing this at the end there, a lot of public speaking gigs for you now as well.
Yeah. Which is definitely a
okay.
plus. And I'm loving it. And it's so funny because, you know, we were briefly chatting about it before we started here, but like 2 years ago, I was terrified of public speaking.
Yeah.
Like, put me on a stage. I don't even think I could walk up there.
Okay.
You know? And then it was funny because when we did BravoCon, this would have been last fall, and I don't even know what it was, but just all of a sudden, I started to really like it. It became really, really fun.
Did you start on a panel or were you by yourself?
Both. There
okay.
were both things.
Got it.
But
mm-hmm.
I, you know, we were all sitting up there together on this panel, and I think that's when it clicked to me that, like, wow, people are listening to what you're saying and you can really effectively help people and right. change people for the better.
Yeah.
Like, this is awesome.
Yeah.
And like, people want to listen to you. And I was like, this is a big deal and it's a big responsibility, you know?
It is.
And so now I just, you know, in my life, I've been through a lot. I've had a lot of people help me along the way. And I've been very lucky and fortunate. I'm a very blessed person. And I know that because I've kind of lived that double life.
Okay.
And so that's why I'm so passionate about helping other people and bringing positive messaging to people. So that they understand that anything they want to do, anything they want to make happen, they can do that.
That's great. Yeah, I agree with that wholeheartedly. It's some of the things that I actually feel like that my life calling was as well. And not only in the dating space, you know, I just feel like, you know, like one of our mutual friend that we know, she's always said, Chris, you know, it's not that you're great at dating coaching or relationship coaching. She goes, you're just great at relationships. You know, you're just good with people. And that's one of the things, like, I just want everyone just to be able to just, first of all, just be honest and open with yes. everything that's across the board. Learn how to be advocates for each other. Learn how to bring each other up, no matter what, if you're male, female, whatever it is, and just be a good person, you know? And that's first and foremost, you know, that's Agreed. One of the things that I always tell my ex-wife. I say, look, I go, they can be assholes in the house. They can be little bitches in the house. I go, but the thing that I care about is when they leave the house every day is, are they being good people outside
yeah.
the home?
Yeah.
And when they come home, they can be that little meow, 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 whatever they want to do. You know what I mean? They can yeah. throw their tantrums. They can yell at us, whatever it is. And it's like, as long as you walk out and you're good, you're polite, you're respectful, you're whatever. That's all I care about. We've done our job really well.
I agree. Mm-hmm. I think to have children that can go out into the world and be those respectful and caring and helpful people.
Please.
It is such an underrated flex.
Right.
It is such a flex.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. And one of my favorite sayings is actually like, just be a good person and the universe will take care of everything
yeah.
else.
You know? It's weird when people, you know, what does that mean? It's like, you know, what do you mean? What does that mean? You know, because they look inside themselves and they realize a lot of them don't think that they are, though, because they're so focused on their own insecurities or whatever it may be, or they feel like they're never good enough. Let's yeah. just start with that as its own self. It's yeah. like, but everyone has something to offer.
100%.
You know, I always say that, you know, when I'm out at a social event or at a party, I make sure that I try to talk to as many people as I can. I don't care if you're this person or that person,
oh, yeah.
you're 10 or you're zero. Mm-hmm. I will talk to everyone to let them know, hey, we're all the same here. Like right. no one's better than anyone. We're all the same. And that's how things should be.
That's right. You know? I couldn't yeah. agree with that more.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, all right, guys. Well, we have Annemarie Wiley on the show and we're going to dive into our top day. We've touched upon a little bit already, but we're going to get a little bit more into your family life and stuff like that. So our top day is called Relationship Check-In Before Checking Out. Being in a relationship is about learning how to live with your lives together as one, but also being able to allow yourself to still live the life that you need to feel balanced and whole as an individual. That's something that we always do a lot of times. So Annemarie, we're going to be talking about being in a relationship, you know, where you're in this thing together. You're a couple now, you know, you're dating, you're single, you're to dating, to being a couple. How do you manage being a couple? You know? And so, I can say for myself that, we just discussed time management, which we get a little more into. You know, I, for one, myself this past year went through a breakup, you know, with my girlfriend of 7 years, and everything was amazing, still is amazing, but we just had one thing that I just could never, I call it my curse, you know, okay. and I'll be quite frankly honest with you people out there. I used to have this thing where I call it the three house curse. You know, you buy a house, you know, and all of a sudden it's like a year later, I'm broken up. And it was this thing where I was like, so the new home, I was like, uh-oh. Buying a house. I was like, and all of a sudden I started going, this is going to be this the third house I bought, you know, with my, and living with someone and da, da, da. And all of a sudden it's like, shit's going to start going down. And it's because I know down the road that it's like something happens where I get this in this space where it's not that I never feel that I measure up, I'm good enough. It's that thing where I'm the type of person where I always need to feel like I'm providing, in other words, I'm handling my end of the court.
Okay.
You know what yep. I mean? Like I'm stepping up and doing what I need to do, handling. And because relationships are about equality. You know,
oh,
it's about,
for sure.
you know, if you're at your lowest, your husband's going to step up. If he's at his low, you're going to step up. It's that 100%. Yin and yang that I tell everyone all the time.
Yeah.
But at this point in time, I think I just got to a point like, you know, a year and a half in where I just got overwhelmed, you know, and I didn't know how to communicate that over being overwhelmed. And so I just didn't communicate at all. I would check in with her and be like, you know, this is what's going on, But then I would never really give her the full reasons on why I was feeling that way. Yep. And then about a year later, you know, she's like, you know what? She goes, this isn't working. And I said, it isn't working. And we mutually just decided to split ways. And now at that moment in time, I, you know, obviously I did therapy and things like that as well. But I also know myself well enough to fix those issues and problems. And I realized that it really wasn't anything that was that bad. I just needed to learn how to be accountable and just to actually speak about why I was feeling the way I did. Mm-hmm. And so moving forward now, a year later, we're back together on strong 6 months later. Love you, honey.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Things are great. But I now know how to communicate the small things that I used to be afraid of communicating. And for me, being a communicator in general, it was very weird for me not to feel like I was too proud, let's just say, right, to actually talk about things. And usually, let's just be honest, it was my financial stuff. You know, she's a doctor. You know, she makes a shitload more money than I do. But it's that thing where it's like, I didn't feel like I was like, you know, not a man enough or things like that, because I never feel that way with anyone. I just felt like I wasn't able to provide the things that I needed to do in those moments. And it scared the hell out of me. Yep. So I just basically just became, you know, mute.
It was shut ego. Down.
Right. But I always tell people it wasn't an ego for me either, because I usually don't run around with an ego as well. What it was is like, I felt guilty because I wasn't able to provide in the way that needed to happen. Okay. In other words, you know, all of a sudden the bulk of it became her and not me. And I feel not that I felt less than that's, I would always say that. And it was never about ego.
Okay.
I just felt like I couldn't help out, and it made me numb, because all I want to do is help.
Yeah.
That's my whole MO in life is like, I never expect anything from people. I never want to take a hand off from or anything like that. Mm-hmm. I always want to make sure that I'm my own person. I am here and we're in this together. But if I would have just communicated, hey, yeah, I need this help with this or that, she would have said all day long.
That's
but to
right.
me, I was like, I didn't know how to ask for that.
Yeah.
And that was the issue.
Yeah. And you know? I mean, that takes work though.
It does.
It takes work. I think number one, you have to be willing to even go there.
Yeah.
You have to be willing to find out why you do
right.
what you do. And I think that's the first step for most people, the first hurdle.
Yeah.
That people don't even want to take that
step. No.
You know?
Yeah.
And
I think I got like over 10, and all of a sudden I started like tripping over each one. I thought, oh, man, I'm tripping and falling. So.
Right. Yeah. But like a lot, you know, people can be very, you know, stubborn in their ways, especially when you're looking at dating in older ages now, right? Like you've spent whatever, 30, 40 years on your own essentially, and now you're coming into a partnership and you've always done things a certain way, but now you have to compromise. You have to not only learn how to communicate effectively, but you have to learn how to communicate in a way that is going to be received.
That's correct.
From the other person. I learned that in therapy.
Good. That's a good way. Say that again, Emery.
Yes.
You have to learn how to communicate in a way that what?
A way that the other person is going to be able to effectively receive
Absolutely. It.
Yeah. Right? Communication is a two-way street. And everyone receives the information through their own lens of their life experiences.
Right.
And everyone's are different. So I could say something to you and you're going to take it one way because of how you have lived your life. And then our mutual friend, I could say it to her in a different way. She's going to have a totally different interpretation of it.
Yeah.
So in communicating with your partner, you need to make sure you know who they are. You understand where they've come from and what they've gone through effectively so that you can communicate in a way that they can receive it.
I love that. Also off of that as well, you know, and guys, don't ever assume. That's one of the biggest things too. Assumptions are another part of this, I always feel like, because in our relationship, you know, like I said, I'm on the go all the time. She's on the go all the time. But after a while, we all start having these assumptions on, well, if you're busy, then I guess I need to be busy, but I'm not going to ask you like say, hey, how long are you busy for? I just assume that you must be busy. So I'm going to keep myself busy. Now we're starting to fall apart as well. These are things that happen as well. So it's ask for what you want and ask, you know, and check in with your person. This is why I'm talking about this relationship checking before checking out, because we both checked out. Honestly. Yeah. And it wasn't that thing. It's not that we didn't love each other. It's like, I just assumed that she was busy. She assumed that I was busy. So we never communicated on, hey, when do you have time to hang out?
Yeah.
Or if you are busy, how long are you busy for?
Right.
Or at least take a minute. Give me a minute.
You know what I think a part of that is? The willingness to be vulnerable. Because if you had just said to her, you know, like, hey,
yeah,
I want some time.
Yeah,
like,
that's
hey,
right. You're
what
right.
What about me? I want some time. Like, I know you're busy. I love and respect that about you.
I'm not
you.
That guy. I don't like butting in like that. I used to not be that guy. You know?
But those are the kinds of things that you have to do in healthy relationships.
Yeah.
You have to be willing to be vulnerable.
Yeah.
And once again, we're strong people, right?
We don't
like to be vulnerable with people because we don't want to be hurt.
Yeah.
But in order to, you know, gain that amazing love that we're all looking for, you have to be willing to be vulnerable with your person.
Yeah. Yeah. I had blindsides. I didn't realize that. Me, yeah, of all people, you know, I had blindsides, you know, like people think, they, wait a minute, you broke up. How did this happen? It's like, you, no. It's like, you're right. There were moments like those assumptions were just the vulnerability because I didn't want her to be like, going, look, I didn't want to feel needy. That was it. But, you know, come on, honey. Like how much more time you got to do this for? It's like, you know,
but what's going to happen if she's like, you're being needy right now. And
right.
That's okay.
That's it. This is true. That's okay. This is why I tell everyone hands. And I go, you need to ask the question because I go, your person can only say yes or no.
That's right.
You're going to get a yes or no answer, right? But you got to ask the question.
You have to ask for what you want.
Okay.
You have to know what it is.
Yes.
You have to ask for it.
Love this.
And you have to be clear.
All right. You're going to be my new therapist, Annemarie. I think you're onto something here.
Lots of therapy. And my husband also has a psychology degree. So
okay, this is great.
I live with this all the time.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. So do you guys, when you need to actually talk about something, and this is for our audience as well, do you set meetings, schedule meetings? I feel like that's hugely important as well.
Yes. It definitely depends on the degree of importance. Mm-hmm. A lot of times throughout our day, we'll be texting and emailing each other.
Okay.
It's ridiculous. Okay. You know what I mean? Like if it's a quick little note, I'm just going to send a text. If it's something that needs a larger conversation later on,
right,
then it's an email. And then we'll literally put let's discuss ...
Great.
And
great.
Then we'll like plan it into our calendar.
Great. All
absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely. Yeah,
that.
You
yeah.
have to.
I think that's something that needs to happen, guys, a lot.
And you know, it kind of does, you know, take away some of like the romance, you know, when you're having to do the, what I like to call the business of the relationship, mm-hmm, but it's essential stuff that has to happen.
It does and have to happen.
You move forward and you have kids, it gets exponentially worse.
Of course.
You know?
But it makes things easier. And what you're saying before, it changes the way that you guys move forward in your relationship. Once mm-hmm. again, the assumptions, the, you know, time management, all these things, like I said, we're nowadays people are both busy, and whether you're a stay-at-home mom or whether you're, you know, working mom or working dad, whatever it may be, you always need to make sure you continuously check in, right? You know what I mean? Because
absolutely.
It's like people with assumptions are not checking in and scheduling meetings, regardless if it's like, you know, I'm mad at you today, but I don't have time to talk right now. Let's schedule this to make sure that you know that I'm mad, but I need to come in and actually come in the right way. Like you said, it's how people need to be communicated to, you know, because if I'm coming in hot, it might not be the way you like that. So I need to schedule something with you and just say, hey, this is what's going on with me. Let's talk about this.
Yeah. And also scheduling later, like with your mad example you just gave, gives you a cool down period.
Yes. Yes, it does.
You know, it's not a very effective conversation when one of the parties is heated. So it gives you a cool down period. So you can, you know, think about what you want to relay to them, and you can say it in a more calm manner.
Love that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, we started journaling as well for the fun of it. I said, let's pick a subject once we just journal on because it's time for us to come together and just kind of, you know, get back that connection as well.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah, because it's just like, you know, you pick anything you want to do.
Yeah.
So, you know, let's talk about, I don't know, what's your favorite restaurant this week? And journal about something like that because it brings you, at least it brings you back on the same page.
Yeah.
And I'm sure, as you know, when we are busy in our schedule of checking in and checking out, it's sometimes really hard to connect. You know, because it's like, you almost like when you have that time finally with your husband or with your significant or whoever it may be, it takes a minute to just go, oh, we're in the same room. What do we do now?
Oh, for sure.
And most people are quite awkward, quite frankly, you know, because they haven't seen each other for a while or just don't know what to do with each other anymore.
Do you ever notice when you go to restaurants, you can always tell who's been in a relationship for a long time versus like who's on a date?
Yeah.
You'll see that adorable older couple. They don't say a word to each other. They're like, we've been together for 50 years.
It's like,
nothing new, nothing, you know, to talk about versus like the dating people who are all like enamored and everything. But, you know, it's just the progression in a relationship and you have to find ways to, you know, communicate effectively and also to keep it fresh. I love that journaling idea, you know.
Yeah, it's a good one.
It's just something, you know, unique that you can connect on.
Yeah. And date night is always a good thing as well. But once again, it's like, let me ask you about date night now. Do you have to feel like you do something that you similarly, like, you know, you do, let's say frequently, or do you like, I gotta think outside the box, do something completely different?
No, we are totally routine people.
Okay.
We are creatures of habit.
Good.
Like we're very sporty, as you know. So it's like, you know, we'll go to the Chargers games or we'll go to the Clippers games like we were last night, or, you know, we'll go to our favorite restaurant. Like we're creatures of habit.
That's good.
You know,
but it's stuff that you both enjoy though. And that's what matters the most.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And that's funny that you say that too, because years ago, actually when we first started dating, my husband loves old school rap.
Okay.
I hate it. I grew up in Canada. I like the mainstream stuff. I don't like all the, you know. And so I used to go to concerts with him though. And I used to just do it because, you know, we just started dating I wanted to be the good girlfriend and everything. Mm-hmm. And I think like maybe five concerts in, I was like, honey, I love you, but I can't do this anymore.
Good for you.
Yeah.
Good for you.
I was like, I can't do this anymore. And he respected that. And now he goes with his sister and I don't go to do those things. But we will, yes, make time and we'll do the things that we enjoy with each other. I know some people are, you know, of the mindset that like you kind of have to compromise and sometimes you have to do the things you don't want to do just to spend time with that person. But I find it much more enjoyable when you find something that you both mutually like to
do
together.
I agree with that. Yeah, I agree with that too. Yeah. And I feel like it's something, but I also appreciate what you did at the beginning of that as well. I'm actually in that as well. So I was at the Motley Crue concert in Sunset. And so my girlfriend does not like rock and roll, but she, at the beginning, she went to like Guns N' Roses with me and a few other concerts. And literally now she's like, I knew she didn't like it, you know, but, and so I never asked it. And so I actually go with one of my best friends now and her husband who does not like that either. So we just go off our own, go there. And then my girlfriend and him go off and do their own thing as well. Yeah. So it works out perfectly.
It works out perfectly. Yeah.
I hear that as well. But I also feel like you said, you guys find something that's mutually, that you love to do mutually together.
Yeah.
You know, we're trying to figure out what we want to do together now as far as like something to do. And I think that it might be actually boxing. You know, I was like, hey, if you want to do boxing, and we tried it out one time, we both loved it. But it was that thing where it was something that was new for both of us. That was the thing though, because it's like, I'm not a hiker. You know, I play tennis all day long. I run around a lot. I don't need to be hiking any more than I need to, right? So so I said, let's find something that we can both do together. Mm-hmm. That's probably a little outside the box, but we'll find hopefully a mutual agreement and understanding and love for it, right?
Love that.
It was the boxing thing. So we're going to start doing that as much as we can now. When we have time, the hard part's find the time to do it. We got to make the time to do it
though. Back to that schedule again.
Yeah. All right. So how did the kids fit in this now for you, by the way?
Oh, the kids are always, they're always the first priority in the schedule. So we've got all of their things planned out and then we'll just plan our things around it, you know? Our son is, he's 9. He's really into like, you know, AAU basketball and flag football and stuff like that now. So he's got like the games in the evenings and on the weekend.
That takes up a lot of scheduling.
It does. Mm-hmm. It takes up a lot of time. So, you know, it's definitely a challenge. But we just, you know, again, we prioritize it. We make sure that we can slot it in where when we need to.
Great. That's great.
And it's you know, we have to plan sometimes like weeks in advance in order for it to happen. Like we're not spontaneous people.
Okay.
We can't be. It's like we're not afforded spontaneity anymore. But you know, you just plan it out and prioritize it and make it happen.
Okay. Have you done the split kids yet? You know, like for the athletic
stuff
already?
Absolutely.
Like one parent goes here, the other parent goes here.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
So
I commend you guys for that.
Like we have to, like, cause my son, he's playing flag football, which my husband coaches.
Okay.
And he's playing basketball, which my husband was coaching his team. Now he's on a different team. But so primarily like he's doing all my son's stuff and I'm doing the stuff with the girls, and our girls are 14 months apart. So luckily they do other activities together.
Oh, that's
still
good. Okay.
So yeah, we divide and conquer that way. And you know, cause I don't want the girls to ever feel like, you know, you can't do your activities that you want to do because we have to go to Big Brother's things, you know, but we've been pretty lucky that we haven't had too much overlap yet. I know as they get older, it's going to become more and more challenging. But yeah, we divide and conquer and make sure that we can show up for as many of the kids' things as we can.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
That's really, really cool.
Yeah.
All right. So now I'm gonna ask you about your husband now, because he sounds like an amazing guy. how does he take care of what you need and by that I mean like going, you know what, honey, you've had a busy day, you know, just take some time. I'm going to handle the kids, today. Does he step up in those roles as well?
100%.
That's amazing.
And that's exactly what he
does. This is a good guy. Keep this guy.
I know. Oh, trust me. I'm very lucky and I know how lucky I am. That's exactly what he does. Like he can see when I'm getting overstimulated is my thing.
Okay.
So, you know, when you asked me before, like, how do you handle being this busy and everything? And I'm like, I thrive off of being busy, but that doesn't mean I don't get overstimulated.
Yeah.
And, you'll hear a lot lately about, what do they call it? Like the silent work or the, You know, like the extra mental load that mothers have, especially, you know, because we're the ones who are doing all the like behind the scenes.
Yeah,
things. Like,
of course.
What are they having for school lunch today? Their doctor's appointments, their dentist appointments, figuring out their calendar.
Right.
They need
the things that I say okay to.
Like everything, even the tiniest things. These pants have a hole. You need to get rid of them. Get new pants. Like every little thing you can think of. It's a really big mental load. So add that on to everything else that I'm doing for myself, for my husband, for our household, everything. That's where I get overstimulated.
Okay.
And so my husband, he can tell when that's happening. He knows when that's coming on. Or I'll just tell him like, I need a beat for a minute.
I'm sure.
And then he'll just be like, okay, kids, hop in the car. We're going to Baskin Robbins. And he'll literally just take them for ice cream for 30 minutes
see,
or
that's
an hour
awesome.
Or something.
Yeah. That's great.
And I can just sit there in my office and like decompress or reorganize my thoughts. And then when they get back home, I'm like ready to go and be mom again.
So I love
that. Yeah. He's really, really good with that. Or he'll take the kids in the backyard, kids, let's go in the pool. Like, and he just gives me these little breaks because he knows that I need them, you know?
Right. Love hands on dads. You
yeah.
know,
oh,
it's like
absolutely.
I said, what's the saying that takes a village to raise kids,
oh,
you know?
Oh my goodness. Absolutely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. He's an incredibly, incredibly, devoted and involved father.
Okay.
So, yeah. Because we also have our 25-year-old stepdaughter. And when she was younger, my husband was still playing football in the NFL. So, you know, there were a lot of things, like a lot of milestones in her life that he wasn't 100% there for all the time because he was always playing, right? So now it's almost like he has a second wave of children. And so he's able to do the things that he wasn't able to do the first time. And so I think it just makes him that much more intentional.
That's great.
Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah.
Well, it sounds like an amazing dude. So I'm really happy for you guys with
Thank
that as well.
You.
Yeah. Cause like I said, it's gotta be, everybody's gotta have all hands on deck.
Yeah,
especially and from your sake of it as well. I know regardless though, I always say that the mom still has the bulk of the role regardless, because like you said, it's that mental part of it as well, because it's always like you have to make sure that mental schedule as well as your physical schedule is always there.
Yeah.
You know, we can help out as much as we can. You know, like even with my ex, like, you know, a lot of people still to this day are like, you guys are broken up? Because when they see us together, we're still friendly, you know?
Yeah.
And that's how it happened even when we broke up. I said, we're never going to lose because not only because of our kids, but because of the fact that it's like, look, it's like, you know, I always tell people, I go, you've met each other for a reason. We were together for 17 years, you know, just because stuff happens doesn't mean that you have to have your ego to get in the way to be mad at each other.
Yeah.
So figure it out, especially when you have kids, you know?
100%.
So our kids from day one of, even to this day, when I walked out of the house, like 4 months later after we had our exit strategy, they walked out waving me, bye dad, we'll see you soon. Not crying or anything like that, because you know, we worked that so hard on just make sure that it stayed that way.
Yeah.
And we also told them when it was time to tell them, like months later, hey, mommy, dad are together, but we're gonna be here in your lives, da da da.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing, you know.
Kudos to you guys.
Yeah. So
that is incredible.
Right.
It's so important.
Yeah.
My parents got divorced when I was 10 years old and it wasn't like that.
Okay.
So like, I really commend you guys for doing that.
Well, I think it's like, and I learned from my parents though. So I think that's probably why, because, you know, even though my dad, you know, he was traveling around, you know, cause he was in the army, but also getting his residency, internship and all that stuff, become the doctor he is today. It was that thing where it's like, he had to travel around the country still at certain stops to finish out his army career.
Mm-hmm.
But he always checked in for everything, like for everything. And I always tell people, I never felt like I was without a dad. When it came to that.
Incredible.
And I was like, that's how I want to emulate my life. I go, no matter what, I want to make sure that my mom and him to the day she died were friendly, you know?
Yeah. Isn't that amazing how you take the things from your parents that you want, or you dump the things you don't want.
This is true.
You know?
Yeah. Right. Or we just like, quite frankly, carry some things that, you know, that catch you in the ass later and go, I'm just like my mom or my dad. You know what I mean? That's always going to be there as well.
Oh yes.
And some of the things we try not to bring with us, like you said, that baggage, it's still there sometimes.
Yeah, it's still there.
Yeah.
And once again, that's where therapy comes in.
Those childhood attachments, damn it.
That's right.
You know? So, all right. So what do you, so are you very helpful with your single friends? Do you have any single friends running around?
I do. I do have a lot of single friends.
If I may ask, what is their main component issue right now? Why they're single and what are they looking for?
So they everybody says they're looking for the same thing. They want somebody who is mature and stable and confident and supportive and funny, you know, all the things. Everybody, it's like everybody's got the same requirement list, right?
Right.
But you know, everyone's got the same gripe. Oh, I just can't find anybody good in Los Angeles.
Okay.
And I just don't believe it though.
I don't believe that either.
I don't believe it. I'm like, I met my husband at a club. And I was like, I was in full liability mode when I met my husband. And he still picked me. You know what I mean? Like, I don't believe it. And I'm like, you're a good person. So what's to say there aren't other good people out there, you know? But I think there's a couple of big barriers, I think, here. There's a saying that my husband says, and I find it so funny. Don't miss the boat waiting on the yacht.
Good one. Yes. Good one. I love that saying.
Don't miss the boat waiting on the yacht. I think that a lot of people aren't ready to, you know, face reality and really come to terms with, you know, like what's important versus what's not important in a relationship, right? Like if you're 35 years old, does he really have to be 6'5"?
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, the non-negotiables are a little silly sometimes.
Yeah, exactly.
And these are the things I have to tell people all the time. Like, you got to lower that non-negotiable list down to at least 3 and keep it at less, no more than that.
Right. You know? I'm like, do you want somebody that's 6'5" or do you want somebody that's honest? And I'm totally not saying you can't find that in the same man or anything. I'm just saying, like, you need to kind of have your priorities a little bit, you know, more straight and realistic, right? I'll tell you a story about right before I met my husband. So I actually had a boyfriend of 6.5 years the whole time I was here. And, you know, we would break up periodically and everything. And he was actually my first boyfriend.
Okay.
But I knew that I wasn't going to marry him. Great guy. I just knew that he wasn't the person I was going to marry. And, you know, I had this list in my head. I knew what I was looking for in someone. And my biggest thing was ambition.
Got it.
I wanted someone that was more ambitious than me.
Love that.
I literally was like, I want a caveman. I want somebody to like, because I'm very alpha, as you can tell, right? Like I'm a very alpha female and I can do everything myself, but I don't want to.
Got it.
And
got
it's
it.
Because I can do everything myself that I don't want to. Right?
I hear you. Yeah.
So I was like, I need someone to like club me over the head and take me through life. But I say this to say, I remember when I had this like turning point in my life where I was like, you know what? I'm not going out to the clubs anymore. I'm going to get my master's degree. That's when I became a nurse anesthetist. And I was like, you know what? If I'm looking for this kind of person for my life, for my partner to raise children with, I need to be that person.
Mm-hmm.
I need to be the person that I want to attract.
I hear
in
that.
Essence, because it's like a lot. I think a lot of people have these expectations or these requirements. But then it's like,
they're not doing the work. That's the easiest way to say it. They're not doing the work.
You're not doing the work.
Right.
It's like, you know, you're wanting the most by doing the least.
Yeah.
And, you know.
And guess what that's going to attract?
Right.
You know, like you're going to get this like huge spectrum of like from like this guy that's at 100 and you're like at a 2 and it's never going to match in between. Although you wanted everything on paper with that 100, he's now a 0 because it's like you're not even stepping up to what you thought he was in the first place.
Right. Or like if you can't bring to the table what you're expecting someone else to bring to the table, why are they doing that for you?
Right.
Like
it's very funny.
What I mean?
No,
it's
you're just, right. So one of the biggest things I hear all the time, especially with women nowadays, there's a lot of strong, powerful alpha women out there. And then a lot of guys who want that type of woman, but don't know how to actually be in the same space with that because their ego gets involved or they're feeling like they're lesser than.
So let me tell you, I have a whole theory for that one too.
Okay.
I think that the women need to stop saying, I don't need a man. Stop saying that.
Right.
Please stop saying that, ladies.
Yeah.
Ladies,
please
stop saying that. Because what you're doing, number one, you're putting that out into the universe. I'm very big on manifesting. You're putting that out into the universe. You're stopping all your blessings by doing that. But also, what man wants a woman that says that?
Right.
Like, and again, this is where the put your ego aside. You need to be vulnerable. Remember
how
I was saying about being vulnerable?
Absolutely.
You need to be vulnerable. Yes, I'm alpha. Yes, I have a great job. Yes, I earned this. Yes, I have my own house. Yes, I have all these things. But I want you. And I need you.
Right.
Don't say I want a man, but I don't need a man.
And,
nobody
and
wants
see,
to hear
see
that.
How he like responds to all this and see how he handles it. Yeah.
Nobody wants that.
Agreed.
You know what I mean? Because, and you know, we all want, and I don't care what woman says, like they don't need somebody. We all want someone.
We
to
all have, I was
we
at an entrepreneurial mindset talking about this the other night. Like literally I go, I don't care. Like if you're a 24/7 business person, you're working your ass off. You're making all the money in the world. I go, no one wants to be alone.
No.
You know, everybody wants to be with someone.
I know. So I think when women say that, it's really, it's a self-preservation thing. You're saying that because you are, you don't want to be disappointed.
Of course. And you're protecting yourself.
You're protecting mm-hmm. yourself.
Right.
But you need to be vulnerable.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying be vulnerable with everyone, but there are certain people that like, you need to recognize when like, oh, this could be a good one. You need to be vulnerable.
Right.
And you need to like, you need to let them in and just stop saying you don't need a man. Stop saying that. Because you're really pushing them away by doing that. You know?
Okay. I hear you on that for sure. I agree with you. And for the guys out there who think you can step up to the women like that and feel like, even if they're pushing you away, there's a strong man out there that can always change that person's mind. And
100%.
This is some, like I said, like one of the things that I said, I look for strong, independent women. That was always in my MO. My mom was strong and independent. I've been that guy my whole life. I go, I want to be with a woman who needs me for nothing.
Yep.
You know what I mean? Absolutely. I mean, except for what you're saying when girls say that.
Yeah.
Obviously, you know, they'll find out why we're there in that sense. But I know it's like, for me, it's like, it's about learning how to match up with that person, letting them know you can let your guard down. You don't have to be as hard anymore.
Yes.
Let go of that facade. When you're with me, just be you.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I
but
love
you know
that.
Why you can do that? Because you're confident.
That this is very true.
That's
I'm very confident, Annemarie.
Yes,
you got that right.
And that's why you can do that.
Yeah.
Versus like someone who's not confident, they can't, I don't know. It's just like, again, they can't be vulnerable. They can't. I just lost my train of thought.
No, you're gonna say. I feel like you're gonna say they can't measure up because once again, it's like in that way, the vulnerability and all that stuff. Are you talking about from the women or for the guy?
Oh, you know what? This is what my thought was. It's a weeding out process. A man that, you know, you said you love strong women. You look for that kind of thing. You look for that because you're confident.
Yeah.
Because you know that you have more to bring to the table versus somebody that doesn't. And so when women say that, like, oh, you know, I'm successful. My dating pool gets smaller and smaller. I'm like, wonderful.
Right.
You're weeding people out. This is wonderful. That's an excellent thing.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Because when my husband met me and he was like, great. I love that you have all these things and do all these things. Like, Because I can handle that.
Absolutely.
And more.
Yep.
You know what I mean?
Right.
So you want to weed that out.
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah, it's a thing. And so that's why I'm curious. So I asked the question about a lot of your single friends, because it seems like it's across the board the same story, just in different ways.
Yeah.
And obviously, like a lot of them either have some issues that they still have, they're like holding, internalizing as well, that they're still not sure that they can get rid of and things as well. So we all have these wants. We all have these needs. But at the same time, it's like, I always say work on yourself first, people, because if you cannot work on yourself first, you're just missing the boat, like your husband said.
100%. Mm-hmm. And be consistent. You know what I mean? When you say, these are the things that I want, act accordingly, because it's very confusing. You know what I mean? Like, I have single friends who, you know, they're like, I want to be in a relationship and, you know, I want something serious, but then you're out four nights a week with all, with the group of single women. And I know you have to have fun and nobody wants to stay at home and be lonely, but like, you know, that's not moving in that
kind
of direction.
No, it's not.
Do you know what I mean? That's like,
Plus, not helping your options out
it's
there.
It's not.
Very
it's
much
saying
either.
I'm perpetually stuck in my 20s. You know, that's just you have to move in accordance with what you want with everything in life.
Yeah, moving forward.
Yeah,
totally. Oh my God, this has been amazing today. So, but before we leave, though, I want to talk to you about just a little bit about your philanthropic endeavors as well. You know, so tell me what you're working on right now and what foundations you're supporting and all those things before we go today.
Yeah. So my husband and I started our foundation, Project Transition, in 2018.
Okay.
And so we work to educate and empower youth in underserved communities. So my background and why it's important to me, I'm biracial, Dutch and Nigerian. I was put up for adoption when I was born.
Okay.
I was adopted by an Indonesian family, grew up in a very small farm town in Canada. Parents got divorced when I was 10, you know, so I came from very humble beginnings. And sports was my, you know, vehicle to be able to go to school, to get my nursing degree. And then I moved down here. My husband is from Compton, ended up going to Columbia playing football. You know, so we were both really those fork in the road kids that we had a lot of people helping us though. Along our way. And so with our foundation, we mentor our students. We work with them through youth camps. We run a lot of football camps and like things like that. We want kids to be greater than their greatest excuse. And we want them to know that they belong in any room that they enter into.
Love that.
So yes, that is the work that we do with our foundation, Project Transition. I'm also involved with the March of Dimes.
Love that.
And
good.
I love them so much. That one is wonderful because it blends like three of my greatest passions: healthcare, being a mommy, and the babies.
That's great.
Right? So
great.
They do so much work with, you know, around prenatal care, changing policies at local and federal levels, supporting NICU families. I just chaired, co-chaired an event for them this past Sunday, a fundraiser for them, and it was fantastic. And I'll be doing more work with them going forward.
Okay.
So, yeah.
All right. Do you try to attend other people's charities as well? Obviously,
all
I know
the
time. You're probably getting like inundated with a lot of, hey, can you support, come visit, or come whatever.
Yeah. All the time.
Okay.
I will never be too busy for philanthropic endeavors.
Love that.
Because like I said, I had so many people that helped me along the way. I've been on the other side.
Okay.
You know, I very humble beginnings, like you guys, really humble beginnings. Very blessed to be in the position that I'm in now, where people want to hear what I have to say, and that I'm able to give back either, you know, time, talent, treasure, whatever it is that I'm able to help other people with. That I will always show up for that.
That's amazing. That's amazing. Well, I love your story, and I'm very grateful and thankful that you came to do the show today. Thank you so much.
Thank
it means
you so
a lot
much
to
for
me.
Having
yeah.
Me.
Yeah. Guys, this is Annemarie Wiley, and you know, before we go out, just make sure that you listen to her, what she said today. It's very important. Also, like, check out her foundations as well, her personal foundation, most importantly, support, and just quite frankly, like I said, your goal and the reason why I do this show is just first and foremost about relationships, but in all forms of and walks of life, the relationships, just not about dating, just not about being married, just not divorce, and all those things. We talk about everything on this show. I want to let, this was a good example today of someone who's just this amazing woman who just now is in this amazing life. And just, quite frankly, you know what? You're just a gold star, you know?
Oh, thank
and that,
you.
And that's because, and that's something that you learn from very young until who you are now. You know, you never changed who you are. And that's something that's super important. You know, like you saw what you wanted for your life and there you are. You know, yeah. I tell people that all the time, manifesting and, but 100%. Just being yourself. Don't ever change who you are. And 100%. That's one of the biggest things I say all the time. So,
yeah.
All right, Annemarie, this has been wonderful. Thank you so much for doing the show today.
Thank you, Chris. I had such a great time.
All right, guys. All right. So before we leave, remember, you can find me out on social media at my own personal at FetSport. And if you need anything, just go to dating-intelligence.com. Anybody need of any coaching service or anything like that, I'm your guide. Trust me. I tell you like it is. It's all you guys know out there who have been with me in my sessions before. Other than that, I'll talk to you on the next episode, and we are out.